Interview the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines. Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. In the studio with us is actor Mitchell Whitfield. Mitchell was born in Brooklyn, graduated from the High School of the Performing Arts, and attended on scholarship Colgate University. You've seen him in films My Cousin Vinny, Reversal of Fortune, and Dogfight, and he's going to tell us all about Mitchell Whitfield. How'd you get started in show business?
Well, I rarely get a chance to say this seriously, but you know, when I first started in the business, in the late 40s. How did I get started in the business? Well, I guess I was around it when I was younger. My mother was an actress, a singer. She was on Broadway early on, and Jacques Brel's Alive and Well, Living in Paris, the original cast of that. So I would travel around with her when she would travel with the show. Chicago or Florida and Broadway, and so I got a sense of it early on, and my dad was a reporter and a newsman, so I'd go to the studio and see him there. So I was exposed to that sort of thing. But
then how did you get to the High School of the Performing Arts?
Well, my mother was dating this guy, Jay, he was really cool. She was dating this man, he was an actor, and he was doing a show, an equity show, summer stock, called 1,000 Clowns. And they said they needed like a 12, 13-year-old kid for the part, and they had all these guys auditioning, and he said to my mom, why don't you let Mitchell audition? You know, he seems like natural. And she's like, well, if he wants to, you know, not wanting to push me, you know, because she did it or my dad was around it. So I said, yeah, I'll go audition. And I went, and I had the audition. It involved like playing a ukulele, which I could do. It's one of those worthless skills. Ukulele, yes! I can play the ukulele. Like, when do you think it'll come in handy? But it did. So I had my little ukulele, and I did the audition, and I came back, and my mother said, how'd it go? I said, oh, I got it. And she went, did you find out yet? I said, no, but I know I got it. And she said, Mitchell, I have to. She gave me the sit-down talk about how many people audition, and, you know, don't expect it because you'll be disappointed. And half an hour later, we got the call that said, I got it. And I was like, see, Ma? I mean, you know, and she was like, okay, well, we'll save that talk for another time.
That was
good. And that was my first job.
Is that it?
Yeah, that was my first job. That was
well,
a good...
Were you singing around the house with your mom?
Yeah.
Do you have a singing voice?
Yes, I do.
Do you?
I do, yeah, I sing. I used to do jingles in New York, too.
Well, you were in the high school.
Yeah.
And going to school. Did you have to audition to get in?
Yeah, you did. But unlike the TV and movie versions of this school, you know, the actors didn't have to sing.
Oh,
and the singers didn't. In fact, we didn't even, in performing arts, we didn't have singers. That was music and art. But now it's all together and there are singers and stuff.
That's what I thought.
But,
so you got in just on your acting
skills. Yeah, just on acting. Yes.
Your acting.
Why do you give me that look? You got in just on your acting skills. You fooled them.
That was very good.
Yeah.
So you continued. You
I
went
continued.
To Colgate on
went
a scholarship.
Until I stopped.
What kind
yes.
of scholarship would, a, would this actor get?
Well, I'll have you know, my academics were highly celebrated around New York City.
Were they?
Yeah. I was good in math and biology and English, and I'd won all these academic awards, which was great.
But did you win those at the High School of the...
Yeah, they do have a good... You know, people are thinking, oh, you just sit around, you know, sing on the lunch tables and kind of like, ooh, fame.
Exactly.
But it's
Is
not
that
like
what you
that.
Do?
No, well, you know, people have, you know, get up and sing on the tables, but we make fun of those people. Like, hey, get up the table, Steve. Jerk. So we make fun of them. There was a really good academic program. There was, you know, great math and science department. And I tried. I was one of these kids. I wasn't a nerd. It wasn't like pushing up the glasses, you know. But I always did, worked hard on my academics, you know, on all the studies. And I ended up getting all these honors, you know, ranked number 22 in Manhattan in math. So I used that. I used the academic part to get me into college because I didn't want to pursue, you know, I didn't want to go to an acting college.
But when you were actually in high school and in college, were you doing other work?
No, when you go well, when you go to performing arts, one of the rules they have is you're not allowed to do any professional work.
Oh, you can.
No, occasionally
well,
they'll make
you
an
doing?
Exception. You study. You're working on your studies.
Oh, I thought you were making commercials and
you're
doing
You're not
touring.
Really supposed to.
Oh.
You know, if it doesn't interfere with school.
Excuse me. But, am I telling secrets?
No, but I'll let you in on a few.
Okay.
Some people did.
I see.
Some people did work, and occasionally we'd go on an audition, you know, and kind of sneak around.
I see.
But for the most part, they wanted you. There was another school called PCS, Professional Children's School, and they catered to, like, young working actors where you could do make a study program around, you know, your business schedule if you're doing a Broadway show, whatever. Performing arts, you were there to learn, couldn't work.
I see.
So
I see.
It was
then
different.
When did you start going on these touring companies?
Well, when I finished with Colgate University after my third year, when they said, Mitchell, you seem very distracted flying back and forth to New York. Why don't you take a year off? And I was like, oh, okay. And I took a year off.
Where was Colgate? Where
Colgate's in Hamilton, New York. It's in central, you know, like,
so
yeehaw!
It wasn't like flying too far then.
It wasn't, but, you know, it was still a trip. To drive, it was 4 hours, so you had to do the flying thing to save time. And my grades started going down because I was auditioning and working, and so I took a year off, got the grades back up, and during that year, I was cast in Brighton Beach Memoirs, touring company of Brighton Beach Memoirs.
Did you go all across the country with that?
Not all across. I visited about four, Chicago, Detroit, Pennsylvania, New Hampshire. It was a smaller scale below, like, the national tour.
But important venues.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It was great exposure. And it was one, you know, Brighton Beach Memoirs and any of those Neil Simon plays, any of the trilogy. They're like great platforms for an actor. Do I have white things around my mouth?
It seems like it should be you.
No.
Do I?
No, why do I? That's a good reaction. No, I'm looking. It's like, how about
you? Excuse me.
No, I'm worried about me.
But were you, but isn't that Neil Simon your kind of thing?
Definitely. It was great. It was my sense of humor, and it was my background. And like I said, any of those plays are a great platform for a young actor. I mean, it's a showcase for that character and for any actor.
And from there. From touring,
right,
and from being on Broadway,
right,
and from doing, or from being off Broadway,
right,
doing plays, whatever. How'd you get into film?
It took a while.
It
took a while because, you know, at every, and I joke about this all the time with my friends, at every level of your career, there's a different problem. At first, it's like getting people to see you. Then it's getting people to see you in a different way. Then it's getting them to see you for different parts in the way that they want to see you. And then the other, you know, see you for other parts in a different way. So at the beginning levels, it was, okay, just breaking in, getting a few commercials, okay. Getting in, having people hire you for theater. Okay, you did that. But making the move from theater to film, it's like, well, who's hired you before? No one.
Exactly.
Well, then we can't hire you.
Right.
So it was a matter of, there's this reversal of fortune.
Was that your first one?
That was my first film.
Oh, it was.
And they didn't want to see me for the longest time.
And you played Dershowitz's
One of his assistants. Yeah, named Curly. And I think by looking at me, it's obvious why.
But you, who was that, Ron Silver?
Ron Silver, yeah. He was curlier than me. They called my character Curly. It was very disturbing. I don't know. And I did that film. And after that, it kind of opens up the door a little bit. It's like, well, so-and-so's hired you. Okay, I can hire you now. It kind of validates you as a film actor. Well, someone's hired you for film. I can put you in mine.
It's almost like doing talk shows. If someone takes the chance on you first, then everyone wants you.
It's like, I discovered him. Mitchell Whitfield. Yeah, I told him he'd be in films his whole life. Great.
Okay, so now we have Vinny.
Right.
And that was the next one?
No, actually, in between.
Vinny.
We'll get to Vinny. First, it was Dogfight came after that. When I moved out to L.A., the first 6 months I was here, got a movie called Dogfight.
You got reversal while you were still living in New York?
While I was in New York.
Good for you.
And it was after that I realized if I'm going to be doing films, I should be in L.A., so I came out here.
Okay.
And then I did a film called Dogfight with River Phoenix. And after that came the Vinny experience, which was like big thing for me. It still is, you know.
Written by Dale Lonner.
Yes.
Our good friend.
It was good of you to mention him. I'm sure he'll appreciate it. Yes,
he's
Dale.
He's great.
Yes, he is.
And we have a clip of you. I'm sure everyone remembers you, as you say. You got your face on the screen.
But you know what? Still, it's, you know, my cousin, who were you? It's like, well, you know, Ralph Macchio? Yeah, I was the other guy.
But that's okay.
That's
isn't
good.
It?
That's
they
a good reference
you.
One. I was the other guy. So I'm the other guy.
Okay, we'll see you as the other guy with Joe Pesci and Ralph
Macchio.
Have you had any murder cases before?
No, this would be my first.
Your first?
Yeah.
What kind of cases have you had? Assault and battery, armed robbery, you know?
No. Well, I expect he's done burglary, grand theft auto, drugs, right, Vin? Nope. Nothing like that either.
What kind of law do you practice?
Well, up till now, personal injury.
Well, you're a trial attorney, right? I mean, personal injury trials.
Well, actually, this would be my first foray into the trial process. I haven't had to go to court yet. Knock on wood.
You haven't had to go to court yet. How long have you been practicing?
almost 6 weeks.
But, Ben, you graduated from law school 6 years ago. What have you been doing since?
Studying for the bar.
6 years?
Uh-huh.
That's a lot of studying.
Well, you know, to be honest with you, I didn't pass my first time out.
That's okay. He probably passed the second time, right?
I'm afraid not.
Three times a charm?
Not for me, it isn't. Nope. For me, six times was a charm.
Six times.
That's so great. I can't believe it. I mean, that dialogue was written for you.
It seemed like it was. Did you improvise at all? We did occasionally. And every once in a while, we had Jonathan Lynn was our director. And he'd pause, and he's English, so a lot of, you know, the American references, you know, he's very funny, he has a great sense of humor, but some of the references were very American, so I'd say something, you know, ad lib, and say, is that funny?
Is that funny?
Oh, that's good. Because in the prison scene, you know, I'm talking earlier on one of the prison scenes, I say, you know what happens in these places? You know, some guy named Bubba wants to make you his girlfriend, and he's like, cut. Originally, it was just written, you know, some guy. And I said, Bubba, because it seemed like a guy in jail that would want to molest me. Bubba. So he said, God, is Bubba funny? Yes, Bubba's funny. Good. And everyone's like, yeah, that's funny, Bubba.
So this is so strange, yeah, though, to have such an American film.
Exactly, yeah, with an English director.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
But it worked.
It did work.
And everyone loves it, and everyone has it in their library at home, and everybody sees it 100 times.
It's very strange. And I still, you know, it's been a little while since the film came out. On video and on pay TV and stuff. People are like, hey, I know you.
Just when you think
momentum is gone, people are like, who are you?
Yeah, but so, you have that kind of familiar face too.
Yeah, people don't quite know, you know.
Was it different when you came to Hollywood from stage to film?
Not really. I guess things, you have to scale down your performance a little bit. You can't, you know, they have the camera, which kind of, you know, magnifies, amplifies everything. You go, well, I think for this, it's like, all right, can you quiet down, Mitchell? This is, you know, is film.
What about the directing? Do they take different kinds of chances, directors?
In film as opposed to theater? Well, what happens is you have the luxury of going through a process when you're doing theater. When you're doing a play, you usually have 4 to 6 weeks of rehearsal. You get to work out the kinks. The director is there constantly to work out, you know, all the, you know, rough spots. So you get to create there. On a film, you don't have the luxury of time. So everything that happens, all the exchanges that happen, you know, among the actors and between the actor and the director are very quick, and you better be very sure the day before, because you find out the day before, like, what three pages you're doing the next day, what exactly you want to do. You communicate with the director beforehand to make sure you get to do what you want to do, because you don't have the luxury of a process with film. Just kind of, okay, we're shooting that. Oh, what happened before? Because you shoot out a sequence.
We're
starting on page 80 on day one. It's like, well, what happened? You have to remember everything that happened up until then and keep on doing your homework so you remember what's happened to the character up until that point.
But you've done it very well.
Thank you.
I mean, because people know who you are, you've taken Hollywood by storm. And since you're such a big star now, Mitchell, before we leave.
Yes.
Mitchell.
Sorry, go on.
Yes, Mitchell.
I was doing my star hair.
What was your biggest indulgence? What did you buy for yourself after you became your star hair person?
The man of the star quality hair.
Yes.
I wasn't one of these people that went crazy, because I've always kind of, when I made money, I've always indulged myself stupidly. So
what
I didn't
stupid
wait.
Things?
I didn't. Oh, I love electronic gadgets and stuff. And my girlfriend's sitting there going, yes, he does. He loves all the gadgets. And I still do. I love all that stuff. When I got my first residual check from my cousin Vinny, which to me was found money. You know,
yes.
The movie's already been out. You made your money. Now it's like, you're giving me all this money for just being on tape?
Yes.
I went and, I hate to say this, it's kind of naughty. I got a CD player for my car.
That was your big indulgence.
Yeah, which
your
in the
car
truck.
Wasn't your big indulgence.
No, the CD player. It's a shuttle, and it plays six CDs like you've never heard.
That's great.
Yeah, that was my indulgence.
Well, we're glad to know it.
Thank you. I'm glad
to
share.
Secret. That's our secret. We won't tell anyone.
No.
And we'll be right back after the break. I can't promise you anyone who can talk as well as Mitchell can.
Oh, stop.
Don't go away. We'll be right back. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and we're back with author Donald Freed. his prize-winning play, Inquest, played on Broadway in 1970. And ever since then, Mr. Freed has been amassing grants and awards for his work. He has taught linguistics, world literature, anthropology, and philosophy at UCLA, UC Irvine, Mount St. Mary's, and USC. His book, In Search of Common Ground, was a dialogue between Eric Erickson and Huey Newton. He brought the two together for a special project at Yale. Mr. Freed's work reflects the political temperature of the time. He's written about Richard Nixon and Gandhi, spies and murderers. His play, Secret Honor, The Last Testament of Richard M. Nixon, is enjoying a 20th anniversary revival at the Fountain Theater. Now, tell us about this, Donald.
Well, the 20th anniversary actually is of the resignation.
Ah.
It's August, and August 20 years ago.
And this play has just won all kinds of awards. It has a life of its own, really, doesn't it?
It has about a 10-year life of its own, and it began in a 30-seat theater on Oxford Street, the old Los Angeles Actors Theater, before it became the Theater Center.
Really?
And there Robert Altman saw the great Philip Baker Hall bringing Richard Nixon to life, and he took the play to New York and Boston, and then to Ann Arbor, where he, Bob Altman, was a guest, a visiting professor, and there they made the film at Ann Arbor with students. And even as you here at Beverly Hills work with professionals and amateurs and students, and you have a rather unique project that you're doing, where parenthetically I taught many years ago in continuing education, adult education. It was not high tech then like this, but you are in some ways my generic descendant, and I'm very impressed with what you're doing.
Oh, and I like that. I like to be descended from you.
Me, a direct descendant. And Bob Altman had this cultural kingdom at Ann Arbor, and there they made the film for just a little bit of money, very little. And it went on to win the Berlin Critics Prize, the BBC Prize, New York Times, Washington Post, and Siskel and Ebert, people who make lists of 10 best films, the Louis B. Mayer Award. It went on and on and on, and is to this day a kind of a cult classic.
Wasn't that an unusual thing to happen for a one-act play? I mean, even today it would be unusual, I think.
Very unusual. I wouldn't say it was a one-act play. I would say it was a play in one act.
A play of one person, I should say.
Right, in one act. It's very unusual. In fact, I can't think of any other example, though there's lots of performance art of single actor performance, but most of those are presentations of some kind. This is not a show or a presentation, it's a play. There's a fourth wall, in other words.
Exactly. That's what's so great. I mean, I think that fourth wall concept is like the really great thing. We have a clip of it. So should we see that, and then we'll go on and talk about what else you're doing.
Exactly.
Okay.
May we take the matter of the pardon first? It was a complete fake. It solved nothing because, well, if there had been a trial and all the rest of it, well, you know, if I had gone to prison, I would be a free man today, a free man. Now, the word pardon has two definitions. First, there is the legal aspect, which is to excuse a convicted man from punishment. Then there is the general definition of the word pardon, which is to forgive.
Can you imagine what did he put on him for makeup to make him look like
Not
that?
Not a thing.
Oh,
not
please.
A thing. And when asked in New York afterwards at a college newspaper conference after a matinee, and they said, how much film, Mr. Hall, have you studied? He said, none at all. He said, I've seen Nixon on television all my life. He said, but I'm from Ohio. I knew thousands of men like that.
Is that right?
And that's the difference with a great actor. He doesn't imitate Nixon at all. You just think that you're inside of Nixon.
I think if you just saw that film come on late at night sometime, you would think that it was a documentary.
You would. And this the great actor does, and long after, in generations to come, who didn't live contemporaneously with Richard Nixon, as we have been privileged to do, they will simply see it not knowing what he looked like any more than we know what Richard III looked like or Henry V.
I guess that's right when you think about it in the context of time. You've written a sister piece. I call it a sister piece because it's about Mrs. Patricia Nixon.
Well called. And it's called The Mysterious Mrs. Nixon. Julie Harris will play Pat Nixon.
Ah.
And it will eventually, I suppose, play in tandem with this. It's not, Julie is reviving the Glass Menagerie in New York now.
Does it start?
It starts a small thing? It starts at the end of this. He leaves, you hear the door slam, and then you hear, Dick. Dick, have you seen this terrible book by Woodward and Bernstein? Dick.
And then
she comes in. The set is exactly as he's left it, awash with liquor bottles, glasses, files, papers, tapes. She looks around, proceeds to have her stroke. Mm. And it's that which is the center of her play.
Oh, dear.
So they will live on now. They're both part of official mythology now, and now they're in the hands of the artists and the mythologists, and we shall see who wins out.
Yeah, it's interesting when you say that, because writing about Gandhi, mm-hmm. I mean, he was already a part of history when you wrote about him. So how do you do the research on something like that?
Well, you know, Jonah, historians and official historians and artists have always fought over events, the interpretation of great people, players, colossal events. In the end, we know who wins. It's the artists who win. It's no contest. But in their own lifetimes, there's no question that the government, with its official mythology, its official line, its propaganda, nothing can stand in its way, and especially with modern technology.
Well, when you say that, but you lived during the Nixon time.
Oh, yeah.
You lived with Huey Newton. You lived with other people. Does it make it easier for you to write about it?
Well, I'm writing against the grain, Joan. You know, if I'm writing about the Rosenbergs, or now I've just written a film about the murder of Martin Luther King.
Well, yeah, you lived during that period.
I did, and I worked with them, and I'm writing what were first, after all, when we started working, and here, one of the first big presentations was at Beverly Hills High School, that Lee Harvey Oswald had not acted alone, that in fact there was a conspiracy in the murder of President Kennedy. Here we spoke to a jammed auditorium at Beverly Hills High School. It was considered a scandal to doubt the official mythology of Dallas. Now, all these years later, everyone knows that there was a terrible cover-up. To use the word cover-up or conspiracy is just simply to move into the realm where the poet or the playwright or the artist works, and she knows or he knows that behind every event is a dynamic, changing ground of smaller events. Vulgarly, this can be called a conspiracy. Artistically, it's called the persistence of style in a life and a time. In the end, the propaganda of the state, which says a loner did it or a scapegoat did it, that's perceived for what it is, as the most vulgar of propaganda.
So you're still interpreting, that was my point, was you're living through that time so you can interpret it through your own eyes. You don't have to really depend on history or papers to tell you what's going on, just like your stories on the Black liberation,
exactly.
Those kind of things.
Exactly.
But do you bring Would it be myth that you're bringing to it,
or counter myth?
Question, or what?
Well, as Oliver Stone said pretty well, I think, about the JFK, he was bringing a counter myth to the official myth of the Warren Commission. Everything is myth. I mean, there's the facticity of journalism, and there's the outright lies of power.
Well, you're a journalist, too.
I am.
You are a journalist.
And I don't disregard the facts, but finally, they are folded into the larger truth. And if you say, well, how would you know what Richard Nixon did when he was alone in his study?
Exactly.
Well, that's the province of art.
Uh-huh.
The artist will know better what the soul of Richard Nixon was and always will be than those who wrote for him or against him when he was just a straw in the changing winds of history.
When you started writing these characters, did you ever think you should be on stage acting them out as well?
Well, you know, I was the director of a theater for a long time.
No, I didn't. Where?
Here in Los Angeles, and I've worked in the theater all my life, really. And it's the oldest of the arts, you know, and so it's the natural ground for the humanities, for journalism, for everything that holds the mirror up to nature.
But are you satisfied with the way your words are spoken? Maybe that's what I'm trying
to ask. Well, with Philip Baker Hall, you see one of the great performances of our time.
I hear you talking that way.
When Bob Altman went to cast the film, he was told to use various stars, and he said, no, this is a once-in-a-lifetime performance. And to have Julie Harris is to have the first actress.
Well, you couldn't play that.
Right.
I know you couldn't do that.
To go to London and work with Harold Pinter and Faye Dunaway and Jack Lemmon in different plays was almost a perfect contentment for me. I've enjoyed, we have great talent in the American theater, and I've enjoyed working, I think, with great talent.
So there is no conflict as far as you're feeling you should be.
Oh, should be playing all the parts?
Yes, that's
not at all. No, not at all. No, it's as Shakespeare said, surely you see to the life here, Joan, when you see an actor like Philip Baker Hall, in Shakespeare's words, become the abstract and brief chronicle of the times.
And that's what we've done today. We've become a brief chronicle of our time with you, Donald Freed. I appreciate so much your coming. Thank you very much, and lots of luck. Your work is like riveting, and I know you'll keep it up.
Thanks.
Thank you for watching today, and thanks for writing all those letters to 520 South Grand. And we'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles. Bye.